business because with long sentences and whatever and conditions, I think I reckon about 7 of the women suffered from anorexia. And both the sisters, of course, they've been through a terrible time in their imprisonment and suffered from severe illnesses. And in my chaplaincy, I succeeded in gathering a huge amount of material and documents concerning them, people interested in their plight, medical people, politicians, and people like yourselves interested in fair play and justice. And those sources, I hope, will be useful to their solicitor, and I've given copies for that from them. So, as has been said here tonight, so severe was their illness that both received an accelerated release, they call it that. They were very ill. And I remember, it's a picture that I never forget, going to see Dollars in the security wing at Muscat Park Hospital, which was closed and confined, and she was brought up to see me, and she was almost a skeleton. She had suffered so much and had lost so much weight and was so ill. And what did I see? She was handcuffed within the security prison, the security hospital wing, to the wheelchair. I never forget that sight. Where in the world would you have a picture like that? Cardinal Tomas Fee, and I just mentioned him because he became friendly with them and he visited the prison a number of times, and he was one of the concerned people, and there were very many who pleaded for their release on the grounds of their health, etc. And even from their release, they still have suffered from recurrent illnesses, and apart from all the illnesses mentioned here, Maureen suffers from severe arthritis. Well, to repeat what has already been said, the Secretary of State, I was going to call him the Right Honourable, Mr. Owen Paterson, I might withdraw that remark, revoked Maureen's licence, as it has been said, after the judge had granted her bail in the recent court case. So that severe action has had strong repercussions among the nationalist community. That is why this is such a huge audience here tonight. Congratulations for coming. And look what's all here about internment. Well, what else is it? Only internment. And it is a form of internment. And internment, mainly against Catholics and Nationalist Republicans in the 1970s, was one of the main causes of the continuation of conflict and a sort of hopelessness growing among people of justice. And what had followed the tradition of the British government, will they ever learn? Who had cruelly imposed internment on nationalists and republicans in every decade of the Stormont government regime. And after the 70s, did we ever think we would see internment brought in again under another guise? And this cruel attitude of the Secretary of State has again been shown in the question of pardon. That royal prerogative of mercy that was mentioned. Where's the mercy? Granted to Maureen in 1980. And were we not astounded, or were we surprised to learn that the British authorities can't find it or be discredited? How many thousands of documents will they not let people see in the question of justice? Now, her case, as is shown here tonight, will widen. It will widen into a global concern regarding injustice on the part of British government. Her plight will receive the attention of international human rights organisations, and we have sought their help for 30, 40 years. And it is affecting concerned citizens here this evening. And as also has been said here tonight, added to the factor of Maureen's illnesses, is her cruel detention in solitary confinement. Her isolation from other people is a serious cause of worry to her family and adds to the severity of her ill health. least a God and acknowledge me. I've had no word from Owen Patterson. He didn't even acknowledge my letter. What's he going to do? Is he going to revoke my license? What's he up to? Just as I was going over this and thinking back, I did publish once, at the request of Mercia Press, my annual reports on my prison, and I just turned back to that period when Marion and others were very ill, and I looked at 1979, and well, I sort of preached a sermon using John Paul II's words in his first encyclical. And I don't know whether the authorities were interested in John Paul II's first encyclical. However, I thought it was relevant. He spoke of the all importance of the concrete, historical, live individual, the dignity of the human person, the person with the name. Will they always continue to give a number to a prison, a prisoner? Why can't they give the name? Number, number, number. Are you a person at all? Or, as the prison officers now and I used to, well, some of the men among them used to always refer to the prisoners as inmates. So we wouldn't want to appear, our society wouldn't want to appear as upstart authorities taking advantage of their vulnerability, as some politicians have. All morality and human rights, at least a person's commitment to these things, can be summed up in our attitude to this man or woman with a name. It's not a number. It's Marion Price, a person, with all the wonder of a human person. Not some abstract man or woman. Well, I remember in that same year, 1980, when Marion was released, I attended an international permanent commission of Catholic chaplains in Lucerne in Switzerland, representing the North here, where I made the following remarks about women prisoners, and was just interested to see what I said then. And I think we can pick up some of the words from it and some of the feelings that I said then in 1980. I feel that the Church has a special duty in the case of women prisoners for whom jail, even in reasonably relaxed and enlightened conditions, is a burden altogether unsuitable for them to bear even for a short period. I feel that the Church should campaign for the recognition policy of a policy that women who offend against the laws of society would be kept in more hospital type institutions rather than be sent to prison cells. The Church has been challenged much of late in regard to its attitude to women. It has based its defence of its current policies very much on the psychology, mentality and endurance between men and women. It must recognise that the longing for friendship and companionship makes women particularly unsuited for life in harsh prison conditions. A repressive and abusive system of confinement seems like hell to them. I regret to report to the Assembly of Europe here that certain aspects of the prison system for women in the north of Ireland come close to cruel confinement. I appeal to my fellow prison chaplains to take that same close interest in the case of individual prisoners and their rights and sufferings in my prison of Armagh, as I have suggested to be the duty of the Church in every land. Any institution of the state which destroys a person or diminishes him or her or damages physical health, spirituality or mental well-being is an immoral institution and cannot be supported. All institutions of the state must prove their value to humankind by their ability to improve the lot of people. Many jail systems do not do this. Why should I be repeating that 30 years later. Any lesson ever learned? Now, maybe I am prejudiced. Would you believe it? England has always, I don't say Britain, England has always used force to deal with the Irish. No attempt has been made to secure consent by generous treatment. It would not, of course, succeed in holding the border in the long run, but it would improve the situation quite dramatically. Habeas corpus was suspended during the entire 19th century, except under Gladstone. And the pattern of repression has continued. Concessions will only be used when violence has ceased. The British say. Instead of using concessions and fair play to bring violence to an end, no dialogue is pursued with the nationalist community. The British government and the Northern Ireland Office are as anxious to hold on to a no-inch policy.